Good morning all, this is Prasanthi here today with Middleware Technologies Lab. The task one that we'll be discussing is create a distributed application to download various files from various servers using RMI. In order to implement this, we'll be seeing the simple program that is add two members using RMI. We'll see how to add two members using RMI application. Before going for the implementation part of this, we'll see what is RMI first. RMI is a remote method invocation. Remote method invocation in the sense, invoke a method that is present at some remote location. That is, we are trying to invoke. Invoke means call a method. Method means it is a procedure or a method or a function. You can call anything. You are invoking a method or a function. Where is that function present? That function is present at some remote location. That means that function or method is present in some other system, and that system is at some remote location. Okay. So we are trying to invoke. It allows an object to invoke an object which is running on another machine. Right. And it provides remote communication between Java programs. That is, now suppose I am working on my system on a computer, I want to communicate with a program, and that program is present on some other system, and that system is present at some other remote location. So that program, my program, should communicate with the program that is present in some other system which is present at remote location. These two programs can communicate with each other by using RMI. That is, it is used for building distributed application. So this is the skeleton. This is the skeleton of the RMI, remote method invocation system. So here we have these things. One is client and server, and the other one is server and the skeleton. So what is the primary aim of the client? Client will be requesting for a service, isn't it? Who will provide the response for this client? Server will provide the response for this client, right? So here, service, what service will have? Service has all the services or objects with it. Now, server has all the services or objects. You can call service or object, both are same. Server has all the services or objects with it. So whenever client will request for a service, here is a client. Suppose client is requested for some service. What is that service? It can be any kind of service, or it can be an addition of two numbers or multiplication of two numbers, or it wants a bank service or any service. Another client will request a service. That request is not directly sent to the server. In between, we have two things called as the stub and the skeleton. Okay. So what is stub and what is skeleton first? So this stub acts as an interface or a gateway to the client and the skeleton and the service. Stub acts as an interface or line or gateway at this side, and skeleton acts as an interface or gateway at the server side. Okay, so whenever a client requests a service, then that service, that request is not sent directly to the server. It is first sent to the stub. Whatever the client requests, that request is sent to the stub. Stub will receive that request and then send that request through the internet to the skeleton gateway, which is the gateway of the server. Now skeleton will send the request request which it has got from the stub to the server. Server will process the request, makes the response, and that response is sent back to the skeleton. The skeleton through the internet send that request response to the stub, and then stub in turn send that response back to the client. Right. This is how the request and response are communicated. Clear? Nothing more. Client will create a request. That request is sent to stub. Stub again through the internet sent to the skeleton. Skeleton again and send that request to the server. Server creates a response, send the response back to the skeleton. The skeleton through the internet send the response back to the stub, and that response is sent to the client. Right? So here, server program has the objects, and these objects are invoked by the client. Client program has put a request for those objects which are present on the server. Skeleton and stub. Stub is a gateway at the client side, which is used to communicate with the skeleton. And the skeleton is present on the server side, which is used to communicate with the stub. Okay. Now, if you look at this here, this is the illustration of automated communication. In between client and server, you have one more thing called as registry. Registry is what the service will provide. Service will provide services or objects, isn't it? The services or objects, every server which is providing some services should register with the registry first. This server should register all the services which it is providing with the registry. How that registration is done? Using a method called as a bind or a rebind. Okay. Now, when client wants a request, or client will be looking for a service, isn't it? When client is looking for a service, he first has to put a request to the registry by using lookup method. And the registry will check whether the service which is asked by the client is present in the registry or not. If that service is present in the registry, then the registry will provide the service to the client by using the server. Okay. So what happens first? First, the server will register a service to the registry. Client, whenever it wants a service, by using lookup method, it will see whether it will check whether that service is present in the registry. If that service is present in the registry, then by using server, the request is sent back to the client. So what the client thinks that we are getting the response or other request directly to the server, but in the middle we have a registry. In the middle, this registry is also called as a broker. Okay, this is the illustration of RMI. This is the step 1, step 2, and the step 3. Right. Next, creating an RMI application, we have to define the remote interface first, and then we have to implement that remote interface, then create and start that remote application, then create and start the client application. All the steps we will be seeing in detail in the next class. Okay, thank you.